New product ideas come from a combination of different places. We develop new product line roadmaps. Sometimes ideas come from trade shows. Sometimes ideas come from technical support, where we're trying to solve a customer's problem and nothing in our catalog can meet that need. Sometimes we get lucky and the customer literally says, I want this. What do I need to do to get it made? And sometimes Alex Cable himself actually says, I want this. Hey, my name is Brett Alessio. I am a product development engineer and manager here at Thorlabs. Most of our innovation, I believe, comes from customer feedback. Customers have direct access, and they also have direct access to the president of the company. I mean, it's not many places that have that. So all the time, I'm in meetings with either research and development companies, I'm in meetings with students, in meetings with OEM manufacturers, and they're discussing a product, and typically they have questions about a product, or they know right off the bat that they want something new. And as the industry changes, our products have to change. So I think that's where a lot of our innovation comes from.
So we prototype new designs through a couple different methods. Usually start off as with a 3D print. We'll 3D model everything first. Then you can do your 3D prints. Usually we can do a pass fail even from there of how well this is going to work, because then you have your finalized concept. After that, we can easily bring it down to the machine. We can use the 3D prints to even talk to the machinists and the programmers, make sure we can hold it, make sure we can manufacture what we have. And then some of our prototype and design can just go straight to CNC. Hi, I'm Andrew Costco. I'm the legacy product line manager here at Thorlabs, and I've been here for 11 years. My role actually contains both aspects of engineering and manufacturing. The legacy product group goes through all of our older designs and brings them up to par with manufacturing of today. And then our manufacturing group travels around the assembly floor, finds what could be easier to build, either with changes to the part or changes to how we're assembling with the jig or fixture.
I think one of the most challenging things is that the optical engineer and the physicist, they really want an optic in their system. So what they really want is they want a minimalized piece of Optomech, and they also want it to be even more and more stable year after year. They want to be able to handle higher shock and vibrations year after year. And that takes mass, that takes structure to do that. The biggest challenge is, how do I take something where the desire is to absolutely minimize it and then turn it into something that is extremely stable? And that's where the real art comes in. The years and years of experience, understanding how to take it in the lab and test and verify as you go through your design, understanding how to read the finite element analysis data, how to read the data from the labs, and then feed that back into design and make a second iteration while still meeting the customer's form requirements.
We do more and more testing here before it goes out. So they have their heat chamber in there to go through their standard testing. They have their vibration table over here so they can line everything up, let it go. We get a customer request for something to be inside a vacuum chamber. We can go through the costing of, should it be, you know, in aluminum and acid etched, or are we okay to go with stainless steel and have it passivated just to get all the contaminants out of the metals? And usually a lot of the challenges also just come from what the customer is trying to use it for.
There's data on every single product. We don't just say, okay, we made it work once. Every version, every variation of that product has data, and it doesn't just have one run, it has consecutive runs to prove that it's a repeatable trend. And every single customer special that I do, every single OEM project that I do, we actually test the requirements and we send test reports with the product to the customers. And I think that's one thing that they really appreciate and they're really excited about. This is a component that was designed. It goes inside the chamber of a fusion reactor. And the interesting thing about it is it needed to withstand 250 degrees C temperature, have a very low magnetic permeability, and remain within 10 microns pointing stability and hold an optic to like a one-way flatness. So there was nothing in the industry that can do this, and the people that needed it didn't know where to go. So, you know, we were able to take the physics, take the research, take the manufacturing capabilities, and we actually developed the product, and the product actually works. It doesn't just feel good to know that you're helping support that. The whole manufacturing team knows what we did and everybody's excited, you know, that we were able to develop this simple product and actually bring it to life and help get something much bigger done.
One advantage here is what we like our engineers to do is kind of be a little bit of a Swiss Army knife and do a little bit of everything. There's been times where if a part hasn't worked right, and I'll carve away trying to make sure that we can get it right on the next one or during my own prototyping. You know, keep it simple.
I think engineering excellence is really about the fact that the engineer really cares about the product, really cares about the customer. And in the end, I think what your job really is to place the product in front of the customer, have the customer look at it, look up at you and smile and says, this is exactly what I want.